So we're going to do a half hour on well-being and why taking care of well-being for yourself and those around you, I think, makes good sense. It may be, of course, that different people have different views of well-being and how important it is. It may be that you think it's something that's not particularly on your radar. Or alternatively, it may be that you're well aware of a lot of the reports in the media and what have you lately. I'm hoping to show you why ultimately it makes good sense for you and good sense for your team. If you were brought up in a generation that says, you know, just get on with it, then maybe some of this will be quite interesting, just to see how there's different views. Every generation probably looks at it slightly differently. There was a recent report out from a joint report from the ACCA and the International Federation of Accountants, and they spoke about what Generation Z think about what's important to them. Generation Z think well-being is important along with being authentic and listening, and it's right up there for them with modern tech and having a purpose. And if you read point five on your screen there, it says that Generation Z are worried about the future. They cite well-being as a major concern, and they're attracted to organizations that support their mental health and offer a good work-life balance. It's an unsurprising finding, given the extraordinary impact of COVID-19 over the last year, that remote working may be a particular challenge to younger people in the workforce. Often domestic arrangements might not be ideal for working virtually, or they may live alone and feel isolated with the lack of social engagement. So it's critical for organisations to rethink their employee engagement strategies and ensure they've got appropriate resources in place to help address concerns for their younger employees who might face particular challenges. So some of this ties in with what we've already spoken about today. That report, as I say, was a joint report from ACC and IFAC. But some of you might think, well, who are Generation Z? So I just thought I'd put this slide up. Average age up to 26. So maybe the younger members of the team, certainly the generation above that, maybe age 27 to 40, probably managers to potential partners, perhaps. Generation X, 41 to 56, certainly moving in that direction. And possibly a lot of the current managing partners are at the tail end of Generation X, or perhaps baby boomers. So it's different generation that we're thinking about here. You know, it may be that some of the managing partners were around, or parents were around in time of rationing, that sort of thing. So, you know, there's a little bit of different thinking, and things don't stand still. What is the impact of stress? I think it should be fairly obvious that it can impact the business in reduced attendance. People simply can't face it. Difficulty in concentrating, leading to poor work, takes too long, minds elsewhere. Relationships with clients and prospects suffer. Fallout with other team members, creating disharmony amongst the team in the office. And ultimately, good people leave. Can you relate to that? Have I missed any? That makes sense.
Gordon, just on that fallout with other team members, yeah. I just remember, you know, it goes back a while, but we had a firm, we had a great team, and we always used to say, you know, if it's a bad apple, obviously, you know, the whole barrel rots, so get rid of the bad apple quickly. I think that has changed to some extent now, and certainly for Gen Z, as you've said, which will include most of our, you know, trainees, you know, new graduate joiners, probably just recently peaking, you know, post-qualified.
Yeah.
it's about now not so much just discarding the bad apple, but actually seeing if you can stop the apple rotting in the first place.
Indeed.
And I think that's why this is vital.
Yeah, indeed. What can we do to actually support them and see if that can be turned around? And if you're not offering it, as we saw with the employee value proposition on first session on day one with Paul, it's possible that your competitors are offering that sort of support to attract people in the first place. What is the perceived cause of this stress? This comes from a CIPD report, which is a professional body for HR and people development. Well, 59% report the cause is volume of work, 32% report it's management style. And I think it's long been said that people don't leave because of work, they leave because of what they perceive as management or conflicts within the workplace. 25% report it is non-work factors, 23% report COVID-related anxiety. So this is right up to date report from 2021. 20% report it's relationships at work, and 20% report poor work-life balance. Yes, for the accountants amongst you, that comes to more than 100%. It's an option, pick the top three. But if you're not seen to be doing something about it, then you're in danger of falling behind. So the question really is, what is it people really want? What is it you really want? Is it the holidays, the freedom, the money, perfect partner, perfect business, perfect home? But interestingly, all of these things are external. We think, if only I had this, then I'd be happy. And then generally what happens is, once you get it, the mind says, all right, okay, now I need the next thing, then I'll be happy. We've all heard of the film star or the rock star being driven to the Betty Ford Clinic or whatever in their limousine. They're comfortable in the limousine, but are they really happy or peaceful? Happiness starts from within. Pleasantness within, pleasantness without, isn't that what we crave? Isn't everything else really a consequence of that? And if we have peace and happiness and confidence within, won't many of the external things flow from that? How much of the day when you were 4 or 5 years old, how much of the day did you spend enjoying the day? How much of the time were you in joy? And with all that you've learned and all your experience since, is that proportion increased or decreased? Maybe we're doing something wrong. Pleasantness within the body we call health and pleasure. Pleasantness within the mind we call peace and joy. Pleasantness within the emotions we call love and compassion. Pleasantness within your energies we call bliss, ecstasy. What prevents us from having that? These other things are all external, and we can't direct them entirely ourselves. Pleasantness is internal, and it will likely bring about the external if we're in control of the internal, or at least we can learn to be. Does that make sense? Why would I be speaking to you about this? Well, when I was first studying, I had wanted to go off and do philosophy and psychology at college, and everybody said, that's a bit strange, you better go and do accounts like your dad. So I did, and ultimately joined my father in practice. Unfortunately, he took unwell, and there's no doubt in my mind that part of the reason for that was the workload he took on, the stress, and no mechanism for dealing with it. He took a stroke at age 60, unfortunately, and didn't really get to enjoy his retirement. So that kind of shaped my thinking, and I went back to studying the psychology that had originally caught my interest. I studied, first of all, what they call neuro-linguistic programming. So So I'm a master practitioner in NLP. That's a mouthful for you. Studied mindfulness, hypnosis, EFT, HUNA. So that's really my background in it. What I've created for Armadillo Academy Wellness is these four elements, put what I would like to be able to share into these four elements. And for the past over a year and a half, I think it was April 2020, I started running once a month webinars focusing on mindfulness at the time. It was sort of the hot subject matter, the hot topic. So I've run them monthly for the last year and a half, and now started to pull together a program with workbooks for the members of Armadillo and their team. And we'll be looking to launch that probably in the new year. And this is what it's built around, if I can share this with you. First of all, body, and starting with the breath. Breath is rather important, but we tend to take it for granted, tend to take what we get for free for granted. How long can you last without breathing? Try it. Not very long. Breath is energy, and yet so many people are running all round all day on very little breath. They say, I've got to get this done, and then I've got to get that done, and then I've got to remember this, and I've got an appointment with such and such, and I've got to submit this, and I've got to phone such and speak to them, and then they get home at night, and they flop down the couch, and they go, geez, I've had a hard day. Geez, I'm tired. Of course you're tired. You haven't stopped to take a breath all day. And they say, honey, I'm tired. I've had a long day. And honey says, I'm tired too. Because honey's been doing exactly the same thing. But what if we actually stop to take a breath? So I'm going to come on back onto breathing later. And we'll discuss more on the importance of it. Also in that first element, body, we talk about the importance of hydration and nutrition and exercise, along with the importance of sleep. Your body is 70% water. Your mind is 90% water. Maybe before we reach for the morning coffee, we should start with a large glass of water to replace what was lost overnight. And the trigger for thirst is very similar to the trigger for hunger. So before we reach for the food, maybe reach for the glass of water. In regards to sleep, it's not so much the number of hours that count. Some of us could survive perfectly well on short hours, and some of us need a good 7 hours. But it's the quality of sleep that's important. And what tends to get in the road of the quality of sleep is our own internal dialogue. What if we could help make it much quieter and calmer in there? And we also discuss how the mind affects the body, because the mind does affect the body. How else would you be able to wiggle your toes? There's an expression in NLP that awareness is progression. So just being aware that what you say to yourself affects how you feel, and therefore how you respond, and therefore your results in this world. There's the old Henry Ford quote that says, whether you think you can or you can't, you're right. If you approach something telling yourself you can't do it, you'll probably prove yourself right. If you approach something telling yourself you can do it, you'll probably prove yourself right. We have this internal dialogue that either disempowers ourselves or empowers ourselves. And we're doing it to ourselves. And just being aware of that is a start. I used to teach my team before they went into client meetings to visualize the meeting all the way through going perfectly, covering exactly the topics they wanted to cover in the way they wanted to cover it, and then the client thanking them at the end. Instead of what they had traditionally done, we spend all the time worrying about the questions the client would ask that they didn't know the answer to. What if you teach yourself to visualize it going the way you want it to, exactly the way you want it to? How long does that take? It takes seconds before every meeting. If nothing else, you go into it in a better frame of mind than you would otherwise. And then the four elements we also discuss: responsibility, mindfulness, and meditation. If you think something that someone else can do can change how you feel inside, or something someone else can say can change how you feel inside, then you've given away your power. And most of our negative emotions come from either focusing on something in the past that didn't turn out the way we like it or wish it had, or thinking about something in the future that probably won't happen anyway, so you can feel crap in advance. Why would you do that? And this is why all the philosophies and all the religious texts talk about living in the here and now. Because right here, right now, not thinking about anything from the past, not thinking about anything from the future, what problems do we have? And regard emotions. If you love something, can you also hate it in the same moment? If you love something, can you be afraid of it in the same moment? In exactly the same moment. You could probably switch back and forth real quick. But if you love something, can you be sad about it in the very same moment? Or anxious. If you love something, can you be anxious about it? Maybe the Beatles had it right. And if you can't love it, can you express gratitude for it showing up to teach you something? If you can't express gratitude, can you forgive it? Forgiveness is for you, not for the other person. And if you can't do any of that, could you at least accept it? Because if you don't, you're probably arguing with the wind. How many of our problems come from us wanting things to be different to how they are? But things are how they are. We spend all our time arguing with it. A fear only exists inside our mind, nowhere else. And the fourth element is, of course, goals, value, proposition, motivation. We said earlier, it's funny we could find the time to do the things that we really want to do. So yes, someone else can motivate you, but the best motivation is self-motivation. So we learn how to motivate ourselves, because if we're waiting on someone else, we might have a long wait. So what's the impact of reduced stress? Maybe improved attendance, happy at work, improved concentration, better quality work, more efficient because the mind is on the work, time saved. What was one of the big factors that came up when Ainsley was presenting to us was time. We build better relationships with clients and prospects. We win work. We build good relationships with other team members. We have a harmonious office. And the good people stay and attract similar. So the well-being of yourself and the team, I hope you can see, has these potential benefits. So what can I give you just in this short session that might be useful to you? Well, we spoke about breathing, because when you think about it, everything else can wait. If you feel stressed, they say, you're probably holding your breath in the moment. And to let go of the stress, all you need to do is remember to breathe. And you know how to do that. But interestingly, as adults, we have a certain method of breathing that's maybe not ideal. If you would for me, if you're with me, put your hands on your stomach and take a big deep breath in. And tell me what happens to your stomach when you breathe in. Stick it in the chat if you would. I seem to have lost the chat on my screen actually, Matt. Can you see? When you breathe in, your stomach should go out, it should expand. When you breathe in, you're filling the lungs. So the diaphragm, the lungs, should expand. Most adults, when they breathe in, shoulders go up, stomach comes in. But if you watch a baby, for example, breathing, breathes in, stomach expands. So try it again. Deep breath in through your nose, your hand on your stomach, and allow your stomach to expand. And when you breathe out, your stomach should come back in again. One technique that is commonly used when you come across a stressful situation, if you can catch yourself, you're opening that brown envelope or about to field a call from somebody that you don't particularly want, or you're going to spend 20 minutes on the phone waiting for HMRC to answer. Maybe just practice this. Breathe in for four. Allow your stomach to expand. Then hold it for four. Then breathe out for four. And hold it for four. Maybe do that two or three times. The breath is the key to so much. All the martial arts start with teaching you how to breathe properly. Exercises like yoga spend a lot of their attention on the breath. When you're busy, 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 you need that oxygen to function properly, for the mind to function properly. Gandhi once said that he used to meditate once a day, and then he became so busy he had to meditate twice a day. And you can always find time. How long does that take? One other technique for you that you may not have come across before. I refer to this as Hakka Lao. It comes from an art known as Huna. There's so many messages coming at us, so much information. I think Mo touched on this earlier, that we filter them out. As you listen to my voice, you're not thinking about the chair that's supporting you, or the ground under your feet, or the beating of your heart. Because if all of that was left to you consciously, regulate your body temperature, create new cells, that'd be pretty complicated. But thankfully, your body does it naturally. Consciously, you filter all that out. So try this for me if you would. I want you to focus on a spot in front of you just above eye level. If you've got a camera at the top of your screen, let me focus on the camera for a moment. And then continuing to focus on that spot in front of you, start to expand your attention to the periphery of your field of vision. I've got dual screens in front of me, and if I imagine that there are wing mirrors like my car, even though I'm looking at the camera right in front of me, I start to put more of my attention on the wing mirrors. And just continue to do that for a moment. Even though you're looking at the spot in front of you, start to put more of your awareness and attention on the periphery of your vision. And remember to breathe. And even though you're looking at the spot in front of you, Put more of your awareness and attention on the periphery. And notice what happens inside your head. Has it all gone quiet? For most of you, for most people, that silence is the internal dialogue. So many of us have got such a constant internal dialogue, non-stop through the day, what the Buddhists refer to as the monkey mind, just causing mischief, getting up to something. If you don't give the mind something to do, it'll make something up. People have a rubbish day at work, they go home, they sit down on the couch and they rerun it. Genius. If you practice that technique, it'll probably feel a little bit odd at first because a lot of our time is spent in focused vision. We're looking at paperwork or we're looking at screens or we're focusing on our phone or concentrating on something. And what that does is it switches on the sympathetic nervous system, which is stress, adrenaline. If you go into your peripheral vision, it automatically switches on the parasympathetic nervous system, which is calm, relaxation. Next meeting you have with a client, try it, because you're looking directly at them, but you're focusing on the periphery of your awareness. What you should find is that the silence is the internal dialogue in your head that's saying, what will I ask next? What if they ask about this? Did I remember to add that to the file? What have I got this afternoon? All that non-stop chatter. I hope that worked for you. Just a little quick technique that I suspect you won't come across many other places. When Matt and I first spoke about what we would do with Armadillo Academy, it was all about trying to give people the tools that we could, equip them as best we could to give them the freedom, choices was the word we came up with, Matt, to give people the choice to run their business as they would like to run their business. So it was mindset, tools, training, and confidence to set them free to make the choices that they want to make. Each of us has probably a different thing we want to concentrate in our business for a different reason for running it. But it's having the flexibility to make those choices. As I said at the beginning of this, my own experience, because my father was a CA, was that it was all busy, busy, busy. And I wanted to see if we can help people do it slightly differently. So I hope that not only that short presentation, that short run through, which I'm at the end of, Matt, but also the last 2 days has given you some of the right tools and the right mindset, showing you how we can access the training on behavioral skills, some refer to as soft skills, and empower the team with confidence to create a great place to work. We've come to the end, really, Matt, of our 2 days of Armadillo Live Online.